Came through with a bad bitch and tight britches. Made the whole book on flight, I'm tight vicious. Black boy flies, stupid racks, oysters on my plate. So much bread, I think I got white privilege.
Bow, bow.
What's good, y'all? It's your boy, Swore the Poet, man. And we back with episode 4 on Black Prosperity, man. I got my brother, Cardo, out here with me. The real estate guru, the TikTok sensation. Man. You know, man, I had to bring him on to show love with us, man. Go ahead and introduce yourself to the people.
I appreciate that. My name is Ricardo. I'm from Brooklyn, New York, but I've been in Atlanta for well over a decade. So you could say I'm a Brooklyn-a, you know Brooklyn-a. What I'm saying? Like, they both home.
Yeah.
You know, I've been doing real estate for like the last 5 years when I was in college, graduated from college, and just been sticking with it. So, yeah, now I'm here, and I'm just trying to get bigger, you know what I'm saying? And then hopefully, you know, my brand, you know, we reach out nationwide, and, you know, be the largest black brokerage in the country. That's the ultimate goal, so.
That's beautiful, man, and that's part of the reason I brought you on here. You know, you're from Brooklyn, home of the hustlers, you know, and you know, when I first moved out here, he's one of the first very few people I connected with. And, you know, I guess being that we both Virgos, we took similar interests in each other. You know what I'm saying? And, you know, I'm naturally drawn to people that's out here that work hard trying to make a name for themselves and stuff like that. And it's actually admirable, like, what he's able to do, you know, just knowing his story and his upbringing and where he come from. Man, it's a solid dude right here. And what I really want to touch on a little bit is, like, take us through your journey on becoming a realtor in Atlanta, like, your process, some of the struggles and obstacles you had to overcome. And then after you do that, you know, if you want to drop a little bit of knowledge and game to those that are interested in becoming realtors and those who are interested in becoming homeowners.
All right, so started taking the classes when I was, like, 19, 20, while I was in school. Passed my real estate exam after the fourth time. Took me four times. I ain't gonna lie to you.
That's persistence.
It was and it was $120 every time. And you know, I didn't have no money for real. Like, that fourth time was literally all I had.
That was like, that's it?
Yeah.
That's how I felt my last semester of college, I ain't gonna lie.
You know, it's like, this all I got. So if I don't pass this, I don't know if I'm gonna take this test again.
Yeah.
So I passed it, like, got my license like a month before my 21st birthday and joined, you know, brokerage. It was Keller Williams I had joined with.
Mm-hmm.
And see, I didn't have no real estate knowledge or background. So like when I joined, I was like, all right, where the money at? Where the clients? How do I make my money?
Yeah.
Then I found out, oh, it's on you. Like, you got to come with your own clients. You got to go, you know, hunt. You know, in the better sense of the words, like, you gotta fend for yourself. So once I did that, you know, they tell you to look around your sphere, people who you know. I knew nobody who was buying a house. And like, all my sphere, everybody was struggling. Everybody was trying to get an apartment. Or if they had parents, their parents wasn't homeowners. Or if their parents was homeowners, you know, like, they don't look at you seriously because you're trying to take on, like, this is like the startup, this is my first career.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I'm trying to take it on. And they're like, oh, that's cute. Like, you know, but you've been working with this person for 15, 20 years.
You also were young, too.
Exactly. So it took a while. Like, I didn't make no money my first damn near year in real estate. And, you know, eventually I say this. I know people do it all the time, but sometimes you got to fake it till you make it. And just faked it to this couple, you know. And anytime I didn't know what I was doing or had questions, I'm out here texting my broker, hey, what does this mean? Or what contracts do I need to sign? Or what contracts do I need to send them? And it worked. Got my first check. And that check changed my life. The check was about like $9,000, and you get $9,000 at once at 21 years old. You like, whoa,
I'm wanting something.
Exactly. So then, you know, I just try to keep the momentum building. And prior to COVID, I was really hitting my stride. you know, COVID happened, you know, that was a toughie on everybody. You know, but 2018, 2019, I was closing deals. I was stacking it up, saving bread. You know, so I was able to buy my first crib. And, you know, then I was like, wait a minute. I also want to get into the investing side. So then I bought some land with it too. And, you know, I was like.
So how did you go about, like, intertwining both of those purchases? Because those aren't. To get land and a property, so, that's not easy.
2019 was a crazy year.
Yeah.
It's like, to date, probably my biggest year that I've had in real estate so far. I saved up. I was living at home, saved up about $50,000. Down payment on my crib, $30,000 in all. Closed another deal.
First of all, to save $50,000, I trust you with my money.
I mean,
that takes extreme discipline.
It does.
We're going to give a round of applause for that one. To save $50,000, niggas are with that home when they buy 40 years. They ain't touched the band yet. All right, come on now.
Nah, so I saved $50,000.
Mm-hmm.
It was real easy. My expenses weren't super high. Like, I didn't have a car. No, I actually started selling houses with no car.
Wow.
Yes, I had no whip whatsoever. And then eventually, you know, saved some money, bought my first car. You know, that was a little silver Nissan, you know what I'm saying? So.
Miss point A to point B.
Point A to point Z. You know what I'm saying? Like, it did everything
Word.
That I needed it to do. Uh-huh. And then, you know, like, just started building from there, so then bought the land. Initially, my plans was to build a property on that land. Things kind of gotten delayed. COVID happened. Prices of everything have gone up drastically. So I'm just waiting for the right time. I might consider selling it. I just got a lot going on. I am trying to expand into Florida. So I don't know if I have the time to really dive into like construction or real estate development at this current point in time. But I definitely want to do that in the future. But as far as like anybody who wants to get into real estate, the biggest thing I tell people, it's a high chance you're going to fail. So I don't, you know, people try to push things on other people. Yeah, you should be a real estate agent. I'm going to tell you this now. All them people you be seeing on $1 million listing or who be selling, that's like the iceberg. Vast majority of agents, they don't even sell a house in a year. You know what I'm saying? You sell one house in a year, you're in the top 50%. You sell five, you're in the top 10%. You
know, is there even more of a discrepancy between black realtors and white?
So if you look up the average realtor, it's going to be a 52-year-old white woman that's changed careers, that owns a property.
Mm.
I started as a 20-year-old black male, never owned anything. The best job I had prior to me getting into real estate was me working at Wells Fargo. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, like, there is that. And I also feel like with me as an individual, I have to have all my T's crossed, I's dotted, because the minute I give off that I don't know what I'm talking about, I feel like everything just falls apart. So I have to really be up on my game, whereas, like, I've seen people, whether they be older and black or just older and white or just white in general,
right?
They may not know, or sometimes they'll ask me, like, I'm working in a deal with somebody and they don't know what's going on, but they got the trust in their people more. I don't know why, you know, I don't know what the reason is, but for me, it's like, I got to make sure I have everything in line. So, like, I don't want to say, like, I feel like I have to be a know-it-all, but I have to know a lot of my shit, because the minute I'm like, I don't know, it's an opening for them to be like, I'm going to go work with somebody else. You know what I'm saying? So I always try to find a way. Any client that I've worked with, you know, they can tell you that I work really hard. You know, I'll send them things at 2 o'clock in the morning that they need to sign, or I found some new information, or I found this home that might fit their, you know, what they're looking at. I might send something at like 6 o'clock in the morning. You know, I might be out the country and I'm still helping them, you know, trying to get, you know, home inspections and all these other things situated to get this deal closed. So, like, you know, I do feel like I got to do the most, but I feel like it's a lot of front-end work, because I do feel like once I start to get a little older, it's going to start to, like, have a snowball effect. And I'm not going to have to put in as much work because of the work that I've already put in these past 5 years. So, but I do recommend, where I don't recommend everybody to hop into this industry, because it's cutthroat. It's cutthroat. And nothing's guaranteed until that direct deposit hits your account. Like, you know, I just went through a situation last month where I was a day away from getting, you know, from closing the deal. Buyer wanted to back out.
A day?
Yeah.
That shouldn't be allowed.
It happens. You know, this is, you know, it happens. You work with them for several months on end, and you're a day away from payday, and you don't get paid. Now, imagine, you know, you at your job, and you work, you know, just not even for 5-6 months, but just for 2 weeks. The day before you're supposed to get paid, your boss is like, never mind. We're not paying you.
And, you know, that's going to lead me into my next question, because a lot of people, you know, the way they just portray it on media, oh, you know, just a lot of stuff like, oh, just hop into real estate, just hop into IT. And they don't really explain the causes and effects of it. And it's like, it's not guaranteed. Like you just said, like, you could be banking on that. Like, say if all you do is real estate, that's going to be a tough month or two, depending on your last closing of survival. Like, it could literally be the equivalent to just a regular 9-to-5.
Exactly. In fact, the average salary is around, like, $45,000 a year. And there have been times where, like, you don't have any motion past your closing. So, like, you know, you may close this deal, but you have nobody in the pipeline that's ready to buy, that's ready to sell. So you're going to be sitting for a month, 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, and you have to learn how to budget your money, not only for your expenses, also for taxation purposes. Because when we do get our checks, no taxes are taken out of them. We take out our own taxes. We do deductions and whatnot, blase, blase. I'm not a financial advisor, but, you know, there's ways to get around it. But, you know, you do have to just learn how to budget. And a lot of realtors don't know how to budget, because we get a large sum at once and we're just like, oh, okay.
Fuck it, I'm up now.
Exactly. And I've learned now, like, whenever I do get, you know, whenever I get commissions, it doesn't move me nearly as much as, like, it did when I first got in there. So I might see a check for $7,000, $12,000, $15,000. And the first thing I'm thinking of is, okay, I need a stash somewhere for taxes, somewhere, you know, for saving / investing into the stock market. Diversify your portfolio if you can. Paying off debts, you know, like student loans, when I credit cards, all that, you know, paying that off. And then just getting back on the saddle. Now, it's nice when you have, like, a lot of streams going on, as far as, like, you got this client that's closing in 2 weeks, you got this client closing. But like I said, that is a very small percent of realtors. And I don't want people to just to hop in saying, like, it seems like it's so easy. Because I think that's, like, the biggest misconception is that, like, oh my gosh, like, being a realtor is so easy. You show houses and you get paid. Man, what? If that was the case, no. Like, it's way more than that. It's, like I said, you have to find your clientele. And if you find clientele, they got to be qualified. And it may take time for them to get qualified. Maybe their credit's not right. Maybe they don't have enough money saved. You know, as far as, like, listing, like, you know, getting, you know, sellers. Because that's where the quote-unquote easy money is when you get listings. Especially in the market the last few years. You put your sign in the yard, someone's going to buy the house most of the times, right? But how do you get that business? Got to pick up the phone. Got to make a lot of phone calls.
Being that you are in the real estate industry, like, what is the current, like, those of us on the outside, we know that there's a housing crisis, but really, how bad has inflation hit and affected the market right now? Like, is this really, like, one could argue that maybe this is the time to enter real estate because it is so shaky right now that, like, you have a chance to really go in there and maybe solidify yourself? Or would you argue opposite, like, because of what it is right now, like, is it really profitable right now?
So I'm gonna tell you this. There was a golden period in, like, real estate history, and that happened right around mid-2020. Mm-hmm. Government dropped interest rates to historical all-time lows. And I was telling people then, go ahead. And everybody was like, it's too expensive. Prices have still gone up. Interest rates have also gone back up. So that 2.5% interest rate that you could have gotten in 2020, now you're looking at 6.5%. That's literally the difference between you paying $1,500 a month and $2,200 a month for the same value home. And not even that, that home that was, let's say, $300,000 in 2020, probably around $350 right now. So now the opportunities for you to purchase what you want have drastically increased. And now what everybody does, because everybody thinks that there's some like psychic and some profit, everybody tries to time the market. Mm-hmm. And I tell people, it's like, you just gotta jump. I can't tell you when's the perfect time, when's the right time. You just gotta jump. And I know it can be scary, but part of investing is like, yeah, there is a chance you can lose money, but you're also taking that chance for a gain. You'll never gain anything if you never take that jump. So, you know, when everybody's like, oh, the real estate market's too high, I'm waiting for it to come down. For what? I want people to realize this now. If the real estate market crashes, you will not prosper. And the reason why is because the people who will prosper are the people who have cash on hand, corporations, unless the government steps in, which they're not. They're going to come in, and they've already been doing it, buying up all the lower income homes. Like any home under $300,000, you'll see Zillow, Open Door. They'll just buy all those houses, pricing you out.
That's evident right now going on in Atlanta. Like right here by the stadium, Arthur Blank is buying up all of these homes, these communities. And who's vastly affected by that? Us.
Right.
The black community. That's real. I'm glad you said that.
You know, now getting to that, like with, you know, our people, we're so quick to drop $2,000, $3,000 living in a high rise that we don't own that ultimately, when the lease is up, will increase our rent. Like, I've never heard of, oh, you've been here for 3 years, we're going to give you a decrease in rent. That's never happened. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? They're not like, oh, we're gonna fuck with you. We're going to, you know, lower your, you know, your price. It's like, nah, you've been living here 3 years. You was paying $2,000 a month. Now you're going to be paying $2,700. Now you looking shit-faced. When you could have bought a condo or bought a home, you could have been staying in that home. And I hate the excuse of like, oh, but what if I want to leave? What if I want to leave? You can still leave if you bought your house. You have options. It's your house. You could leave it vacant if you wanted to. And, of course, you'd have to pay your own mortgage and probably rent and or mortgage somewhere else. You could sell it if you wanted to. Mm-hmm. May make a profit, may not make a profit. Or you could rent it out to individuals. You could do short-term, you know, like Airbnbs, which that's a whole nother topic that I have mixed feelings about. You can do a long term where you rent it out for a year. So you have options. You trying to leave or you trying to be on the go and you have an apartment, you could sublease. Cool. That's about it. You can't leave it vacant for real. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, you're still gonna have to pay the rent. You can't sell it. It's not your property to sell. You know, and we're just so caught up in like the amount of excuses I've heard. And I've heard it from people who have the means to buy and whether they're scared to or, you know, it's quote unquote, they're not ready, which you'll just never be ready. You just kind of have to dive in. You know, like I'm seeing other cultures, you know, 21, 22 years old, couple saving up, buy their first little home. 26, 27, they buying a bigger home. You can't buy a bigger home if you didn't plant the seeds to begin with. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, we out here 27, 30 years old, still, I don't know. Like, it's like, you know, we're falling behind. If you look at like the wealth gap between us and white people, the largest factor between the two is, you know, real estate, like owning property. And I feel like more of us just really need to take that initiative and take that chance, you feel me? And because if we own our neighborhoods, you take pride in your neighborhood. You know what I'm saying? Like,
that's true.
You know, you care about, oh, there's trash on the street, or I got to mow my lawn, or, you know, I got to make sure, like, people not acting up in my neighborhood. So you take more pride in what's yours. And I feel like if we can get to that, you know, it could definitely, you know, lead to greater wealth. And it's been happening, especially in Atlanta. But, like, I feel like the last 2 years have kind of made it a lot harder. And honestly, the longer we wait as a people, the less likely it is to, like, actually be a thing. And, you know, we could just be a generation full of renters. So
I feel that. And, man, that was real touching. And, you know, that's really important. Ownership is key. You know, I preach that through that. I'm going through my journey right now to make sure that I'm matching the words that I'm preaching as well. And, you know, in my opinion, though, with that, I feel like the reason that you've been able to prosper is because you use a great marketing tool, as in TikTok. And it's a Crispy Real Estate Living, right?
Crispy Living Real Estate, yeah.
Crispy Living Real Estate. And I think that's very, very in that. You know what I'm saying? That's very, it's very suave of you, you know?
And
how does that work for you? Before we close this up, you know what I'm saying? Just so, you know, the people can know, they can check it out.
You know, follow me on Crispy Living Real Estate, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok. It really started, you know, just like I used to do it on Instagram, like home tours or whatever. And then I stopped because I didn't want to, like, make my Instagram pages all real estate content. Like, you know, I'm still a person. So then created a TikTok where that's what I was focusing on. And then one video started to do good, then another video, then another video. And then next thing you know, like, going from, like, 300 followers, like 5,000 and 12,000 and 20,000. I'm hoping by the end of the year, you know, we hit 30,000, you know, plus followers. And, you know, people are, you know, DMing me from TikTok on Instagram, or they're emailing me having questions about purchasing a house or getting into real estate. And that's really helped my business. Gotten a couple of brand deals. Nothing great yet. Hopefully, you know,
hey,
the good ones come in the future. But, you know, It's been great because it's allowed me to, like, also meet other people in the Atlanta real estate scene. And, you know, we've talked about, like, collabing and just picking ideas from one another on how to grow our business. Because each realtor, in a sense, they're their own business and entity. So it's just kind of like, how do we keep growing and, you know.
So. All right. That's beautiful, man. And look, use y'all resources. The tools are here for y'all, man. You want to get the people some closing remarks as we wrap up this episode, man. Let them know where to follow you. And just get the people something encouraging as we wrap this episode 4 up on Black Prosperity, man.
If you want to follow the personal, it's Ricardo_Olivier. That's probably going to be in the video somewhere. And then if you want to follow my business page, Crispy Living Real Estate, like it across Twitter, TikTok, Instagram. And if you have any questions about real estate, you can always just email me. Down to answer any questions or any concerns that you might have. I'm just here about, like, educating really our generation, millennial / Gen Z, you know, about real estate, and if I could be an asset to you, by all means. So
appreciate you, my brother, man. And that's a wrap on episode 4, man. It's your boy Spo the Poet, man. This is Black Prosperity. Got my brother Cardo, man, and we out, man. Y'all tap in. It's gonna be a banger.